Okay, so dear participants, our resource person is online now. So I will give a brief introduction about him and thereafter we'll start with the today's session. Dr. Pritesh Bharadwaj is an associate professor in Department of Applied Science at IIIT Allahabad. He did his M.Tech in Information Technology from IIIT, thereafter his PhD, and he's joined over here as an assistant professor. So in a way, he is our very own Dr. Pritesh Bharadwaj at IIIT Allahabad. His specialization include computer-aided drug design, machine learning, next generation sequencing. He has a vast experience of about 10 years in the field of bioinformatics. He has published about 100 papers, publications in esteemed different journals. He has published paper in Nature Scientific Reports as well in the field of bioinformatics only. He has organized several conferences, workshops, and he is an expert in bioinformatics in our institute. So now he will give you a brief lecture on algorithms involved in computer-aided drug design. That would be of help to you to understand the mechanism by which the programs work. And this will give you an insight also to behind the scene of the software. And you will learn techniques so that you can make your own small softwares using the techniques that you will learn from him. So now it's over to Dr. Pritesh Bharadwaj. He will take you into his lecture, and thereafter I think you will gain a lot of knowledge from it about the algorithms of the softwares that are being used for computer-aided drug design. Okay, so it's over to Dr. Pritesh Bharadwaj now, sir.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am.
Okay, sir.
Am I audible? Is it audible, ma'am?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Yeah, okay. So let me just put this slide on presentation mode. Hello. Yeah. So, good morning, friends and participants of this workshop. And I'd also like start my lecture. Before that, I just like to thank you, Dr. Niji Mishra, for organizing the whole thing and then assimilating so much of different students and participants from across the country, and then. I would also like to extend my thanks to the team of volunteers and the research scholars who are actually continuously working to make this this particular workshop a successful one. And then I heard that last evening the handout and this lab session was also good, like online practical session was also good. So I also like to highlight few points that today, this 1 hour lecture, I will try to go through in a very with a hope that we'll learn what are the algorithms associated with the docking, and then where exactly as a bioinformatician you can contribute, and then what are the tidbits, technical know-how and technical aspects of all this docking algorithm. And then also, I had a discussion with one of the scholar, Akhilesh, today morning, and he was saying me that After this session, there will be a hands-on with AutoDock, which is actually one of the gold standard software for docking. So during my presentation, while going through the algorithm, also I'll try to, you know, emphasize more on AutoDock, so that although we'll go through almost all the known docking algorithm, but then I'll try to give more emphasis on AutoDock, so that, because that is the one which your people are going to use today. Okay. So before starting, I just want to remind you a few things that let's divide this lecture in such a way that I'll be discussing the thing, and in between months I'll be giving you 5 minutes time, so that you know, if there is some question or doubt, by that time we'll clarify there itself. And I will request Akhiles, if Akhiles is there. Akhiles, are you there?
Yes, sir, I am here.
So Akhiles ji, what you can do, like, if the students are asking any question, I will request them to please write their question in the chat board, and then Akhiles ji will try to check the redundancy and take 2-3 question within that 5 minutes of time, and then we'll try to cover up the entire slide, and then after that again we'll be discussing for another 5 to 10 minutes depending on the type of question we are having. Okay. So this entire lecture I have tried to develop in such a way that this has actually some of the links or preamble which has been already discussed by Professor Nisha last day. Like, she was there and she has given a very good introduction and brief overview of all the softwares and the tools and techniques which is there in computational biology to enable a faster as well as more effective way of drug discovery and drug designing. Now, before starting this docking algorithm, let's think that what exactly is promoting us or promoting as a researcher to do this docking. Now, I'll just go through the preamble, just give another few minutes of preamble, then we'll directly go to the docking algorithm part. Now, this is actually post-genomic era, you know, and post-genomic era means the Human Genome Project has already been over, and then as if you are aware about the fact that when the Human Genome Project started, it started with Sanger sequencing. And in the meantime, the Venter group, they came with the shotgun sequencing technique, and due to the shotgun sequencing speed and the Sanger sequencing accuracy, finally people have merged into both the thing, and then we got the Human Genome Project much before the deadline. But right now, due to the advent of the next generation sequencing or the high throughput sequencing technique, in fact, most of the sequencing technique which used to take few years of time are now can be completed within few hours, you know. And the cost, which is pretty high, like used to take around $3 billion per individual sequencing, right now it's taking something around $1,600. So if you'll just give you $1,600, I can get your complete sequence, genomic sequence, and I can give it in a pen drive to you by let it be 6 or 7 hours of time. So that is how the science has developed in last one decade. So due to that, there are so many of data which is available. And since you know the data is available, you can always map this genomic space into its respective protein space. And when I'm saying protein space, that means you have sufficient targets to work with, or to design a particular inhibitor or ligand for that. And this has also enabled, due to the high performance computing, which actually I think you have already gone through. So you have so many arena of homology modeling, and then threading techniques. And then these computational techniques actually makes this process of finding protein structure much more easier and much more faster, which were cumbersome and hard because of only the involvement of X-ray and crystallography and NMR. But right now, due to the computing process, everything has been fast enough. And then since it has been fast enough, we have sufficient data to play with and to deal with. Similarly, this is the same with the ligand structure. That means the small molecule structure. So we have abundant number of millions of small molecule structure available with us. So now we can, you have both the thing, you have the lock, that is your protein structure or the target, and you have several such key, that those are the small molecule. Now we can somehow take this lock and key, that means this target structure and the protein, the ligand structure, and we can use the array of statistical and model building simulation and through a series of learning algorithm. And one of the main point which I like to discuss here is, and if you'll just see that how the docking algorithm has evolved. So this is because of the graphics and the computation which is available for simulation. So at one point of time, when we started the learning bioinformatics during 2002 or 2004, that time we are using something like SGI, Silicon Graphic Interface Computer. But now you won't be like surprised to find everyone in your pocket, you are having a mobile phone, and the mobile phone graphics and the processor which is there in almost most of the mobile phones, it's actually much more higher than the SGI. So the bottom line is, since the graphics and the computational power has increased enormously, so the way we can do the simulation, because for you know that for any simulation you need a sufficiently good processor and sufficient good graphics. Since these two things are right now easily available, we can go for any good simulation. So this slide simply says about where exactly we are, and I am not going to tell you anything new here, but these are something which has been already discussed by Dr. Nisha last day. So from target identification to target validation to finding a lead or a small molecule, then optimizing this lead, and then going towards the preclinical test like finding the ADME or finding the pharmacodynamics and pharmacokinetics property, doing some simulation and finding a system biology aspect, that how this particular small molecule changes not only the protein, but however it may also change the entire scenario of this biosystem, that is what is the implication of the small molecule on the entire protein network, or you know, how it changes the holistic way how it changes the body. So this can be easily done by a in silico scientist through series of simulation and computational modeling. So I'll just take 1 minute. These are a few things which have been already discussed by Professor Nisha, but then yes, these are important, so I like to just highlight. So according to the last day class, we have seen, if we have both the structure of target as well as small molecule ligand, so if both the ligand and structure of target is known, then we can go for structure-based drug designing. Structure-based drug designing means something like you're doing a docking. So that means you know which is your small molecule, you know which is the protein where it can be fit. Now you take both the structure and do a structure-based comparison, and that is obviously through docking or in silico virtual screening. So we'll be actually, this structure-based drug designing is leading to the docking. When you don't have any target structure, that means your protein structure is not there, but only you are having a bunch of ligand, then you can go for indirect docking, indirect drug designing, or sometimes it is also known as analog-based drug designing. Now, analog-based drug designing example is your QSSR and then QSAR and then your pharmacophore modeling. When you don't have any ligand and you have only the target known, then you can go for something like de novo drug designing, is DNDD. De novo drug designing is something like, you know, if you have a protein structure and you don't know which particular ligand can fit into, so what you can do, you can design a ligand inside the active site of the protein, and there are some docking software which actually do this thing also. So docking will be more of structure-based drug designing and DNDD, that is de novo drug designing. We'll see how exactly it is doing. Now, to make you clear, henceforth, whenever I will say target, I'll be telling more particularly about the protein, although, you know, the target can be also like this pie chart tells a idea that it's not only the protein, rather sometimes it's also the nucleic acid or DNA, which can be act as a target. You know that there are so many drugs which also target the DNA, but we'll be assuming safely that whenever I will say target, I will be telling about the protein. And source, you know that they actually are from the protein data bank, PDB. And the file format is the PDB format. And then there are so many different types of protein which already Nisha madam has told you. They can be, you know, hormone, they can be enzyme, they can be ion channel, they can be receptor and whatnot. Now, similarly, when I'm saying ligand, Ligand is nothing but this is actually a small molecule, and there are so many sources. Like you have chemical library database, and you have you know, Zinc database. There are so many of them, and these are typically falling into some fine formats like your mol file or SDF file. So mol file is actually individual file about a small molecule, and SDF file is a batch file, and the batch file essentially has thousands of molecule into a single file, and then.
So- Excuse me, sir. Sorry to disturb you. Hello, sir. Kindly share your screen once again. Slides are not visible.
Ma'am, it is visible, ma'am. Only thing is, others have to pin it out.
Some people are complaining, so if he shares it once, then slides should be visible. Or
you need to pin that, ma'am. Pin their,
you can card. Pin. You can pin at Dr. Pritesh Varadwaj, and then the slides should be visible.
It's visible, ma'am. It's visible.
Okay. Okay. Then we can continue. Sir, you can continue. Few people were complaining about the slides. Okay, you can continue now. Hello, sir. Are you there? Dear all, he will be presenting it due to some internet fault. The connection was, it was disconnected. Okay, so in a short while, he'll be connecting again.
Is it okay now?
Yes, sir.
I'm so sorry. Okay. So this is the first slide where we started with a very preamble in a very humble way that what exactly is docking. Now, docking is something where we try to simulate the binding between two molecules, okay? And preferably, one of the molecule will be, you know, your target molecule, that is a protein. And then another one is the small molecule, which we try to see that how good or bad it can fit, okay? Now, when I'm saying that we like to simulate this thing, so basically we want to do a model inside the system or your computer to know that how, what is the proximity of these two, what is the association, and if there is an association, what is the binding, what is the binding, and how effective is the binding. So when I'm saying where is the binding, so that is actually one of the challenge which every software has to look that where we need to take this ligand and put it. And second thing is that, you know, that any ligand has so many of rotatable bonds. So when you have a series of rotatable bond, so that means every ligand can create multiple configuration, or I'll say conformation. So in 3D space, it's conformation. If I say in 2D space, it is more of configuration. So when a ligand can have multiple configuration, so your software should say two things. One, that how effectively and where it is binding. Second, it should also tell you that which configuration is giving you the best binding. Okay. So depending on these two things, almost all the docking software which is known till now falls into these two groups. One is your rigid body docking and second one is your flexible docking. Now, this is how the protein surface looks like. This is just a 3D perspective of your surface. So if you just see this surface, there are so many places where there are some concave places and there are some convex groove and furrow throughout the protein surface. So imagine that, suppose I am dealing with a small molecule, like something like this. This small molecule has to be taken into every cavity, every possible cavity on the surface, and we have to evaluate that which particular cavity is having the maximum binding energy. Now, when I'm saying that maximum binding energy, so that means we should also score it, okay? So if you just literally see this thing, any software which is doing the docking are actually doing two things. One is that it is going and searching on the surface where to bind, yes? Once then it binds, it also has to be tell that how effective is the binding. So that means you should have some scoring function. When I'm saying that ligand is coming here and the ligand is coming here, so scoring of this part and scoring of this part need to be told. Okay, so that means every software which do the docking essentially works on two points. One is searching and second one is scoring. Now, what is searching? Searching is actually nothing but it's a sampling of conformational space. So that means in searching, we do two things. One is that we'll search out through the entire solvent accessible surface area of the protein. Kindly put your microphone in the mute mode because there is some echo going on. Yeah. So first you search through the entire surface area of the protein. That is the solvent accessible surface area. And another searching is that given a ligand, which orientation it was. That means if my ligand is having only one rotatable bond, then I'll just check that which particular rotation or which particular orientation is giving the maximum binding. So these two are the searching paradigm. And then finally, when I'm saying I have to search, I have to also evaluate that which particular position is the best position. And for that, you need to give the scoring. Scoring is nothing but you have to find some scoring function by which you can. You can score this protein and ligand complex. And effectively, this scoring is actually going for all the rigid body docking as well as flexible docking. Now let's see what is rigid body docking. So rigid body docking is historically, this is the first approach, you know, when the docking software came into the picture, they are the simplest one. It is more of your simply the safe matching or complementary matching, where you take a protein structure, find out the active site, see the shape of the active site. If you have the shape of the active site, you try to match that which particular ligand is complementary to this active site. So it's like more of, you know, safe matching. And then we have to search relatively less orientation because we don't deal with a more of a orientational changes. Rather, we'll fix this two molecule, protein as well as ligand, at the static molecule and rigid molecule, and we'll simply see that where exactly the binding is maximum. Although none of the software, well, we have dock software, which is the example of this thing, but then right now every software has been evolved and they actually have a bit of flexible docking into the scenario. But moreover, the rigid docking actually do this thing into three different classes. So all the rigid body docking method is nothing but these are the superimposition of the point of set. That means you superimpose a ligand into the active site, and if there is a match, then you score it. If there is no match, if there is some classes in the sense there will be some overlapping of the small molecule with the cavity of the protein. So due to the overlapping or steric classing, you can give some negative scoring. And if there is a perfect match, you give some positive scoring. And finally, by summing of the score of positive and negative, you come with the final score. And that will give you an idea that how effective this docking is. Now, this can be done in three ways. One is your geometric docking or geometric hashing. Second one is poach clustering and then clip detection. Now, let's see that what exactly are this thing and what are the example of this this particular approach. So how exactly the geometric hashing is done? Geometric hashing is very much similar to the, it is actually from the image processing or the computer vision field, where we actually try to take this ligand as an image and protein cavity as an image. And we'll try to see that which two images has the maximum match, okay? And we do it in a, since I'm telling you image, so basically this is actually 2D space. This is actually 2D space scenario. Now let's see. So assuming this is your protein and you know this particular blue dots are nothing but these are the, this is the amino acid which are the functional group of amino acid which are exposed to the cavity. If I know there is a triad of amino acid here, like suppose I'll say this is alanine, this is histidine and this is tyrosine. So if I know this is a triad which is there, I have to simply search what are those ligands. Out of my, you know, I have 10,000 such ligands. So I'll see out of 10,000, which ligand is matching. Or if one ligand is there, I will say out of all the possible orientation of my ligand, which particular orientation is matching with a maximum approximation with this particular triangle. Okay. So this is just a triangle matching, which is there also. There.
So the ligand shown is 3D.
No, it's 2D only. Oh, well, the ligand image is 2D, but then the process is right now, if you see the triangle, this is actually a 2D. Yes?
Okay, sir.
Okay. So it actually do something like this. So for every ligand, we can create the triad. And this, depending on the triad, we have the suppose this is actually three amino acid. I will say alanine and, you know, glutamine or anything. So if you just check this triad and if you have some bond length, depending on the bond length, you can create some hash table. And this hash function tells about so there are three hash function which tells about three possible permutation of the bond length between all such triad which is there in my protein. So that means every active side, if you just see this active side, if I'll make some triangle, so since there are multiple points, I can create multiple such triangle, you know, I can have a triangle like this. I can have a triangle between this through three. So I can have multiple triangle here. So I'll just check that which particular triangle is having maximum match with my ligand triangle. Okay. And wherever it the maximum match is there, I will say this is actually your best matching. Now, there is another technique which is known as poach clustering, where poach clustering, we try to take all those receptor triangles just now we have seen, like, you know, this image. So suppose my receptor is having this thing, this two different scenario to produce the triad. So I will cluster it and I'll see that what is the maximum permutation combination that one particular triad will be taken into account. Okay, so if I'll say this is actually my cavity, and within the cavity I need to put this particular this is actually 2D molecule.
Excuse me, sir.
Now there is actually rotatable bond here, so if I can rotate it.
Hello, excuse me, sir.
Yes,
sir, in rotatable action, do we like some other geometrical shapes?
Just a minute. Like, actually, there are some echoing going on. And then, please, Rajni and Devyan, kindly put your this thing into mute mode. And if you have any question, kindly give it in chat box so that, you know, we can take all this question at one time. Otherwise, you know, this thing will never end. Okay? Because we have 140 fellow here. So if you have, let me just go through the slide. There may be a chance that most of your doubts will be clear by the time we'll finish the slide. Thank you. Gupta, you have to put your thing on mute mode. Achilles, can you please check who are not putting in the mute mode? Yeah. Thank you. So you take this orientation. Orientation means you do this 2D changing. You do the rotatable bund change, and once you can also do it in 3D, because I told you that most of the software, they started with a very simple version of rigid body docking by taking 2D. But right now, due to the enhanced graphics and the processor speed, people are also going into 3D. But it actually starts in 2D. Post clustering starts in 2D. It comes to the respective place, and then whatever rotom or configuration changes it will do through 3D. Then there is something like click detection. Click detection is very similar to your subgraph searching. You know, click is something like a subgraph. So what we try to do that, you know, inside the protein active site, you try to find out what are the graph, assuming every the spheres as one of the van der Waals surface of one of the atom. So we'll create some graph and we'll try to see that this graph can be pretty big. But if a part of the graph is confined within my ligand, that is a click. So if you have a subgraph which is confined within your ligand, which is part of the larger graph of the protein, I'll say that it can match. Okay. In fact, Doc software actually tried to do this this particular scenario. Now there is something like implemental construction. Yeah. So there is a ligand flexibility algorithm is there, which also Doc does. It actually try to increment the molecule. So imagine that you are having a molecule which can be composed of smaller fragments. So you, since it can actually makes your life much more easier, because instead of taking the entire molecule and doing the orientational search within the cavity, what we do, we take a smaller fragment of the molecule, try to match, and then we take the another part of the fragment and match it, and we do it incrementally, step by step. And if you are able to fix all the part of the small molecule, like that means if you can somehow fix all the fragment of the small molecule into the cavity, then we say that this is the best configuration. Okay, now there is a scenario here that sometimes, you know, only the geometric match doesn't give you the best answer, because you know you can have a cavity which has multiple way of arranging one ligand, like this particular configuration. So this particular cavity can hold this molecule at three different places, you know, and in three different orientation. So you have to also somehow say that out of the three orientation, which one is the best one? Okay, now to tell this, you have to also use the scoring function. So we'll be discussing what is the scoring function and how to optimize it. So this land energy landscape tells about what is the binding energy. Now if we'll say, suppose lower the energy or the higher the energy is my strategy to find. So assuming that I will be going towards a low energy configuration or higher bind energy, I mean it depends, because you know, any minimization problem is actually following the concept of duality. So if you want to maximize something, you can always say that I want to write a function which is 1 minus maximize. So 1 minus minimize can also do. Yes, like so any maximization problem can be easily converted back into the minimization problem through the same algorithm. So whatever the case may be, supposingly I want to find out which particular scenario out of these three is giving you the best answer. So obviously this one is giving the best answer. But then to find out which is the giving the best answer, we need to go through the entire landscape of this energy landscape of this docking. And this energy landscape of docking can be searched through multiple optimization algorithms. It can be golden descent, it can steepest descent, it can be golden gradient search, it can be local beam, it can be taboo search. So there are so many searching algorithms. By using any searching algorithm, you can actually go and find out that particular configuration which is giving the maximum energy. obviously there will be some searching algorithm which actually try to take the local minima or local maxima into the consideration. So those algorithms are not very much like encouraged for docking. So docking actually use most of the algorithm which are global optimization algorithm, like your genetic algorithm is there. And then in fact, Autodoc, you are, people are going to use today, it uses genetic algorithm. Then you have Monte Carlo optimization or simulated handling, because these techniques try to search the entire landscape and then it try to do a global searching so that the maximum point, which is maximum in the entire scenario, will be taken out. I guess you know what is global and maxima, global maxima and global local maxima, because if you just see this, this is actually local maxima, because this maxima is having some minima both sides. But if I'll say what is the maxima of the entire scenario, so this may be the global maxima. Yes. So this just now I told. Now these are the software which actually uses this geometric algorithm. Just now we have gone through. They started with a rigid body docking, but right now they also do a lot of changes into their the recent version. Like you know, the recent version of Dock and Flex, they actually use flexible docking also. So now what is flexible docking? Flexible docking, I told you that instead of taking this molecule as a rigid body or simply a shape or complementary matching, they actually try to check that whether there are some possibility of changes in the orientation or the configuration in the molecule itself. So when I'm saying molecule itself, mostly the flexible docking software try to take the ligand molecule as the point of contact, and it do all the changes, orientation changes in the ligand. But there are few software which also do the changes in the protein, because doing changes in the protein structure while doing the docking is pretty much complicated, you know, because there are the number of atoms involved in the entire process makes this scenario much more complicated. So most of the flexible docking software, they actually try to assume the ligand as flexible rather than taking this protein molecule as flexible. Okay, so we have four different way to do this flexible docking. So I'll just start with now this is actually the first thing which also takes care of the protein molecule. I think if people have a slightly this thing, this idea, you know what is force field. So force field is actually one way by which we can give some motion into the molecule which are there in the protein. So essentially here we are dealing with those particular amino acid which is exposed to the active site. So those functional group of the amino acid which is exposed to the active site, where an interaction between this functional group of the amino acid and the interaction between the small molecule or the ligand molecule which we are right now dealing with is possible. So we actually try to do that, because you know the protein actually it's a flexible environment, it's not rigid. So when you try to change this the molecule or the atoms which is involved inside this active site of this protein, we actually use some of the algorithm like leapfrog algorithm, Verlet algorithm, modified Verlet. So they actually are following the Newtonian classical mechanics, and then we actually try to do some changes in the orientational space by doing some wagging or changes in the bond length, changes in the bond angle, and change in the bond orientation. Okay, and also it has the ability to do the elliptic and then Van der Waal force calculation, by which you can essentially give motion to the protein. And then the idea is that you give motion with some time frame, and you try to save a series of such proteins. So that means in time t1 you do some change, in time t2 you do some change, and then you have, suppose, time 100. So that means you have 100 such snapshot of the protein active site. So basically when I'm saying I want to see a movie, so movies are nothing but these are a continuous array of so many images, or discrete image. So we have a discrete space of all those protein active site, and then if you have 1,000 of them or 100 of them, you can say that it has somehow mimics the flexibility of the protein. Okay, but this is a time consuming process because of the amount of calculation involved in this process, but it is one of the most accurate one. So if you have already the idea of the active site, if you know what is the best binding mode, if you know what is the best ligand, then you can certainly go for this thing to do a finer modification or finer correction or the final approach of finding that what is the binding energy. There is another way of doing this sampling. It is through Monte Carlo process. Monte Carlo process starts with it starts with one configuration, and then it accept it as a starting configuration, and then it take the next configuration by simply doing some random changes. So when I'm saying random move, that means suppose you are having in your ligand you have one rotatable bond, so you can rotate it. So random move means you take the same ligand but then a different orientation. That means you actually try to change it once through the rotatable bond. Now that particular configuration, again you score it. If the score between the first is, suppose energy of the first configuration is A and second configuration is B, so you try to compare this E and EB. If you know that EB is further lower, so I will accept it obviously, because we are going for lower configuration, lower score here. You can make it also higher. I mean, it depends on the type of algorithm you are using. But nevertheless, if I am saying that my second configuration is better, so I will take it. But if it is not better, then I am not going to throw it. The reason is, if I just go through the slide. Yeah. So if I say, if I'm going like this, this configuration is better than this, yes? Or at least a configuration which is sitting here is better than this. But to go from this particular area to this area, you need to pass through the bad configuration also. Is it clear? So if you want to pass through the bad configuration, if you simply say that whatever the best you take it and bad you don't take it, so that means you cannot come to this place, because you have to go through a series of bad configuration for this good configuration. Okay, so it says if the configuration of the next orientation is, or the energy associated with the next configuration is good, you take it. If it is bad, you take it with a probability. And probability is actually a very minimal term. It is exponential equation of which actually try to take this daily. It's the difference between the energy of both thing divided by KTT is a temperature factor. It's a constant which is pretty high. So if you take something divided by exponential equation minus divided by KT, if you make this T as a larger amount, so obviously the probability of selecting it will be more when the T is more, and the probability of selecting it will be less when the T will be less. And that is what the simulated annealing says. Okay, the simulated annealing is this technique by which we try to take this temperature, that is the T factor, which is actually a higher factor or higher number, like something like 10 to the power 5. And then every iteration or every 100 of iteration, you try to minimize the T. And once you are going to minimize the T, you are actually fixing the P more and more. So the probability of taking a bad configuration will be further lessened. So at one particular time, you will find that you start. So here this motion is pretty fast because the temperature is high. And finally, at one point of time, your temperature will be low. And then you cannot go through the bad. Whatever the good is only you have to find. So the idea is that if you'll just do it for thousands and thousands of iteration, then there is a maximum probability that your solution space will be landing to somewhere where your global maxima is there. Then this is actually one of the most famous algorithm, genetic algorithm, global optimization algorithm, which is being used for almost all the top gold standard software, I will say. Gold standard software means those software which are being used commercially and by academician, and they have been proved to give surprisingly good result, in the sense they are able to mimic the X-ray and the crystallography data. So that means if I take a ligand and protein, and if I do NMR study or X-ray study out of this, whatever structural information I can get, if I can do through my similar information if I can do through my simulation algorithm, like docking algorithm. So I'll say this algorithm is pretty good. So almost all those algorithms like docking, autodock, and then bold, they actually try to follow the genetic algorithm. So genetic algorithm is nothing but here every movement of ligand, that is translation, rotation, and configurational changes, are being denoted by some property. So if I'll say just for example, if I'll say rotation, if there are three rotatable bond, so every rotatable bond is having 18 such rotation. So how 18? That means every bond can rotate for 360 degrees. So if I'll say I'll give a step of 20 degree rotation, so every rotatable bond can produce 18 such configuration. Yes. And if you are having three rotatable bonds, so it's three multiplied by, so it's actually not multiplied by, but so so if you have three rotatable bonds, every rotatable bond is suppose 20 degree rotation, so those number of configuration can be hard coded into a string. So if you have a string, then what is the process of genetic algorithm. So you have some operator like crossover, mutation, and natural selection by which you can change this. So this is how you have to initialize. Then you have to evaluate the scoring function. If the scoring function is not good, you try to do the selection through crossover. That means intermixing two such configuration, and you do some mutation. And after mutation and crossover, the new generation will be again sorted out depending on the scoring function, and then finally we'll replace it so that the final population will be remain intact. So that means if we'll start with the population size of 100, you create some new population just through crossover and mutation, and suppose you are creating 20 such things, so at the end of the day you have 120 such population size, but then you will remove out 20 worst perform thing and you will keep only the 100 best performance. And then you repeat it again and again with the hope that at one point of time, the best possible configuration, or I will say the global maxima, will be within your solution space. So this is just one of the example which I was telling you. So that means if this particular, like, you know, if this configuration is giving +2 and this configuration is giving -22 kilocalorie, and then these are four configurations, you will see that since we are having -22 and -13, so obviously these two will actually remove out because they are giving some plus energy which is not required. So that means through crossover and mutation we have created four subsample, but then we found that two samples are not good, only these two will be intact for the next generation. So this is actually the next generation where we have taken the two, like this one and this one, which are giving good, and then we will again do the mutation and crossover to find two new population or two new sample to evaluate the scoring. Then there is something like, I told you, there is something like your de novo docking, where we actually try to, since this method is being used when you don't have any idea on the ligand to use, you have only a receptor structure available with us, so you can go to the cavity and then you try to take the fragment library. There is some library of molecules which is already existing and available with us. So I will try to take those fragment from the library. I will take one by one fragment, and then I will try to join the fragment depending on the active site triad which is present inside this protein. And while doing so, I may come with a new ligand which is de novo, which is absolutely a new molecule to start with. Although we have to also see that whatever molecule is being generated by the in silico method is also feasible for synthesis or not, but then we can create some new molecule out of this process. So this is one of the example of this thing is your league builder. Now I'll just go through very quickly about the scoring function. So we have three different type of scoring. Mostly one is empirical scoring, force field based scoring, and knowledge based scoring. Empirical scoring is more of, we have gone through the database. That means supposedly right now I am having 150,000 protein ligand complexes in my PDB. So I will take out all those protein with its associated ligand, which is attached and which is being verified by the X-ray crystallography method. So I'll just try to download in and try to find out what are the essential parameters. That means what is the distance of every point of your active site into the ligand molecule, and then what are the possibility of finding the hydrogen bonding, and what are the different perspective of this particular binding, and I'll make a statistics out of it, and I'll use this particular statistic to score any new configuration. Let's see how it will be clear in this. So if I know that in my data set of 150,000 molecules, suppose 1.5 lakh complexes I have taken, protein and ligand complexes, and then I found that whenever there is some hydrogen bonding, the hydrogen bonding is like this, or whenever some ionic bonding, the ionic bonding actually follow a certain distance and a certain propensity. So given a scenario of a new docking, I can actually take the statistics which I have already found out from my database to score it. Then there is something like force field based docking, where we actually try to score it depending on the van der Waals force and the electrostatic interaction. This is actually one of the most accurate of way of doing this thing, but it's also time consuming, because you know, you can imagine the number of atom essentially involved into the docking process. So for every pair of atom, if you are finding this electrostatic and van der Waals, and then you are summarizing through all the atom of protein and all the atom of ligand into the concentration, that means within a particular distance zone, this process is a bit more time consuming, but it's accurate. Then this is actually one of the most popular and mostly used way of doing the scoring. This is known as knowledge based scoring, where we actually try to score that how close my binding is. That means whenever I am doing a docking, it will try to score that how close the binding is to the binding which is already there in nature. So that means it is something similar to your empirical formula. So if I have 1 lakh such structure of or 10,000 such structure of receptor and molecule, and then I know that whenever there is a receptor and a molecule is there, the molecule is having a suppose a hydrogen bond donor. So I know that this donor molecule or the donor atom is always maintaining 4 angstrom distance, suppose, you know, and if there is a histidine, from histidine amino acid, this particular atom is giving a 4 angstrom distance. So that means I know that if in nature it is following 4 angstrom, so, and in my configuration, in my docking also, it is following 4 angstrom. So I will give a positive score. But if in my docking, it is giving something else different, you know, it is giving some distance which is 8 angstrom, which is not there in nature. It's not following the natural trend, which is we have already evaluated through the statistical learning. Then I will try to give it some negative scoring. So in that way, we can make some positive and negative penalty. And then we can, this is actually the fastest one. This is the most fast way of doing the scoring. Now, just to summarize the thing, we will take all this database of known protein and ligand structure, all this excess structure we will take, complex structure we will take, and then we'll try to find out the non-bonded interaction, and then we can find out the empirical scoring function. Similarly, we can also find out the distance. Just now I told you, like 4 angstrom example I have given. So the distance can be also taken between the ligand and receptor pair of atoms, and then this distances can give me a scoring, some like knowledge-based scoring. So any of my docking, if it is following this particular trend of distance, I will say it's positive. If it is not following the trend of the distance which I have created, I will say it's a negative penalty score. And finally, the summarized score will tell you that how bad or good your docking is. However, you can also do some force field docking, which is actually, so this is actually the van der Waals way. So, and then you can also see the electrostatic interaction between every such atomic pair of your ligand and protein. So this is also what few of the advantages and disadvantages I have already just now discussed. So I'll just come to the limitation part. So, you know, all the docking molecule or docking algorithms are proved to be a boon in last decades. And so I can say with some assumption that, you know, 99% of the drug designing work, they happens to include the docking process, because it's one of the mostly essential process. But then we have to also very much sincere enough when we are doing the docking, because you know the type of protein data file we are using, and that was the reason in the very first slide I told what is the data format. So when you are taking the PDB file, you know that PDB file doesn't have hydrogen, and the hydrogen bonds network and the protonation state of few amino acid, those are actually some of the missing criteria which is in your protein. And also water molecule play important role in your binding of your protein and ligand. So there are some water network, although softwares like Autodoc and then other software which are right now being used like your Glide and Ludi, they have other modalities to add the water molecule. So in Autodoc you will see that Achilles G will tell you that how you can add water molecule before doing the docking. Similarly, you have to also do a lot of pre-processing the ligand, because you have to use the ligand to protonation state. You have to also fix what are the rotatable bond. Few of the rotatable bond can create some problems, so you can make it stationary. So there are some pre-processing required in the ligand. So what exactly I'm saying is that before doing the docking, you need to have some domain knowledge of the protein and the ligand you are playing with. Then, yes, we somehow confined to the flexibility of docking, because we cannot take all the flexibility of docking. It used to take a hell lot of time, so we have to somehow make it rigid at one point of time. And similarly, same is with the protein. I told you that giving flexibility into the protein atom is very cumbersome and very tedious. Although we have the processor speed has been enormous, but still then it's a challenge. And molecular dynamic docking is one of the example I just now told. And then which scoring function you can choose, that also gives a different attribute toward your accuracy. Like, you know, if you which scoring function you will choose, that depends on how fast your algorithm will be, and it will also tell you that how accurate your algorithm will be. Now within 2-3 minutes I'll just summarize the Autodoc, then we will try to take the questions from the participants. So today the software Autodoc you are using is actually doing, so I'll just tell you the thing which just now we have gone through in that perspective. So the idea is that you have to create a grid box around your entire protein molecule. So this is actually protein molecule where you can change the XYZ component and you can make a grid. And within the grid box, we can have some subgrid box. And this subgrid box is here, the spacing between this. And every part of the spacing box will be framed by probe molecule. So there are some probe molecule. Probe molecule will do what? It will do the entire scanning of the entire surface of the protein. So if I will say simply, I will put a probe which is there for electronegative atom. So that means the entire surface of the protein will be scanned wherever there is a atom which is electronegative. I will have a list of those atoms. And similarly, I can take something polar. So I will take a probe which is there to find the polar surface. So that particular the surface which is polar enough will be listed out. So that means by taking different probes and fixing at a different grid point and doing it throughout the box, I can map this entire protein into its respective surface. So this may be a polar surface. We can have another surface of only for the electronegative atom, and then we can actually create multiple sub scenario of the surface. And if you know the surface, that means you know this cavity is there where there is a maximum proximity that one polar surface is there, so that or I will say that one of the functional group is there which is feasible for my ligand molecule to find some activity. So instead of searching through the entire surface, what I will do, what the software actually try to do, it actually try to take the ligand and put it here only. Okay. And then it try to score it. And since the searching is being used in your Autodoc, it actually try to use the simulated annealing searching just now, which we have created, gone through. It used the Monte Carlo optimization. That means when you are finding a good good sample, you accept it. If you are finding a bad sample, you accept it with some Boltzmann constant with a probability which is confined to your temperature. So that is a known region is known as your simulated annealing. So temperature is nothing to deal with the temperature, rather it's actually factor which is actually constant factor which try to minimize in every iteration. Then you have genetic algorithm here. It actually uses the Lamarckian genetic algorithm. Autodoc uses Lamarckian genetic algorithm is very much similar to genetic algorithm, but the only changes will be in genetic algorithm we try to do the changes in the genotype space with a hope that the phenotype will be changed. In Lamarckian genetic algorithm, we do some bias. That means depending on the phenotype, we do some changes in the phenotype itself so that it will be more suitable for binding. And accordingly, the genotype will be changed. So I don't think this is actually an avenue to discuss in a very great detail what is Lamarckian genetic algorithm, but we'll certainly like to take some question at a later point of time that how exactly Lamarckian genetic algorithm is different from the genetic algorithm. So that's it for now. So this is actually a small group which works here with us. So these are the research scholar and this is our lab, and we do a lot of data science and machine learning. So I am closed with I'm done with my presentation now. I would like to take the question if you have any. Thank you.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, hello.
So there are some questions. The first one is like, what is the significance of adding water and does it have any impact on docking score?
Yeah, so adding water into the docking actually makes, it has very, very significant role to play, because if you are more interested, you can go through the concept of water network. Somebody's there. Water network. So water network actually try to facilitate a avenue where more number of hydrogen bonding is possible. So due to this creation of the avenue for creating more number of hydrogen bonds, so addition of water molecule do a lot of changes in the overall binding energy. This thing. So it's I will say simply summarize it. It's very, very essential, and we do have a program to do this thing. From IIIT, the program name is Ankush. It is developed by one of my colleagues. So Ankush software is there free of cost. It's one of the widely used software to add water molecule into the docking. Thank you.
Sir, the main purpose of adding hydrogen is to water is to get more hydrogen atoms.
What do you mean by hydrogen atom? No, I am saying what is docking software? Docking software is nothing but it's a simulation by which you can know that how effectively your small molecule is binding to your protein. Yes. Now, since the the protein which we are right now dealing with, it's not in a dry state. It's inside the body, which is immersed inside a aqueous medium. So obviously, All these active side which is there of the protein are also filled with water molecule. Yes. And
right.
Then
yes, sir.
There is a role of water molecule. Like if you are asking, I'll just give you 1 minute. Like, when in your active site, there are 5 water molecules approached. When your ligand is going and binding inside the active site, these 5 molecules will be released. Yes.
Right.
And since these 5 molecules are released, so there is a change in the entropy. Yes. So this entropy
right.
is, and due to the change in the entropy, overall enthalpy equation will be right now changed. So that means just removing this 5 molecule of water from the active site, you are actually changing the entropy. So that del H equal to del G minus T del S, del G equal to del minus T del S. So that del T if you are changing, so that means the overall binding energy will also change.
Okay, sir. Understood.
Sorry, sir. So is it the hydration cell layer, like whatever happens in the hydration layer?
Yeah.
And do you mind just reviewing the beginning of AutoDock page?
Yeah, when you do the AutoDock simulation, you will be told how to add the water molecule today.
No, not that one. So when you were going through your presentation, there were a lot of noise throughout. So it was a bit hard to follow. So first, the concepts that you went over were the parameters or the conditions on which one can do the optimization, or the limitations, preparation limitations, scoring factor, and all that. And then you did give us some introduction to AutoDock, like the software actually. So could you just go over that slide?
Yeah, actually the AutoDock will be in a great detail will be discussed in your lab, but I simply try to correlate my presentation and I'll finalize with the AutoDock. I'll just go through that slide just a minute.
Sure.
Yeah.
Okay, and here when you were like introducing the protein or ligand, so basically it depends on what target system we are considering. It can vary, like of course it's going to vary from person to person, like what is your target protein or what is your target. So for example, right now, like with the COVID going on, so suppose a person wants to look into the COVID thing, so first we have to identify a particular receptor protein or something like that, and then only we can think about the docking, right? Like I mean, to fit something into that.
Let me just go through. So can you just put your this thing on mute mode so that there is
Mute
thing? So the idea is that, you know, it may be COVID or it may be anything else, so you have to find out what is the essential target molecule. So in COVID recently, there are some paper which has mostly 90% of the paper right now in COVID are dealing with one target, that is actually a protease enzyme. But then there are some other paper which also deals with spike protein as well as nucleocapsid protein. So whatever the protein may be, first you have to go through the pathway that how essential one protein is, whether the protein is also part of the human system or not. Otherwise, you know, you don't need to block it. So what is that particular protein which is essentially confined to only this virus or bacteria right now we are dealing with? How effective it is to stop the propagation or the infection? Now, once you find the target, then you can take it and then you can do the docking through autodock. Obviously, the protein size will be different, shape will be different. So the grid box need to be changed accordingly, and then it is everything is there in the software, so you can do it easily. I think I'm clear.
Yes, sir. This one question that I typed in: how do we choose our first ligand? So once you take your target protein, then how do you?
There are two ways to do this thing. One is that when you don't have any idea about which ligand to choose, so what you can do is you can do the virtual screening. So that means there are some ligand database which runs into few millions of the ligand. You can take one by one. There are some faster searching algorithm or docking algorithm like your dock, which essentially do not do the force field scoring, because I told you force field scoring is pretty faster. Force field scoring is pretty accurate, but it's very slow. So there are some software which you can try to go through all these millions of molecules by using something like your knowledge-based scoring. And once they find 100 or 200 top ranked molecule through the knowledge base, then they will go through one by one into a more effective way of scoring it by something like the force field scoring. So if you don't have any idea that which molecule to start with, you can...
Sir, can't we use ligand flexibility algorithm to get our first ligand?
You can use, but then there are so many different factors that whether the ligand you are using is synthesizable or not, whether it is following all the ADME parameters or not. So there are some molecules which are already FDA approved. So FDA approved molecule list is already there. Like I can share with you people, like we have 35,000 molecules which are already approved and gone through the ADME property. Yes. So if you want to directly start your instead of going through the long clinical trial phase, if you directly want to start one of the molecules which is already there in market, you can take this set of 35,000 database and you can try one by one. And whichever happens with the maximum proximity or maximum binding energy, you can say this is the winner, and then you can go through as a lead, and then you optimize the lead. So are you close or anything else?
Hello.
Achilles?
Sir, as you just said that for any database, like virtual screening can help us to screen a lot of ligands from a million of databases. So can you just tell any one database that we can use for virtual screening of ligand?
Yeah, you can write it on the Jinc is one of those database. Jinc, J-I-N-C. Then you have in NCBI, you can go and download the database there. NCBI has its own chemical database. And there are so many of them. It's there in internet, but I will suggest you try to go for some database which are pretty authentic, and you are not supposing to start with some data which are inaccurate or wrong enough, because you know any inaccurate or wrong data can give you wrong result. So when you are downloading the data and taking from particular data source, be more sure that which particular data source you are using.
Okay, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Sorry, good sir, but this sir. Is the last one. Sorry, just a second. Are we going to be given any introduction to virtual screening in the hands-on session, or do we have to go for separate learning platforms for that?
I don't know. I mean, it's Nidhi ma'am's call. I think Autodoc is there. Autodoc is actually doing something which is docking. But then if you take millions of molecules and do the Autodoc, it's not possible because it used to take more time, but it's more accurate. Yes. If you know what is docking and what is how to do the docking by Autodoc, certainly you can use any other software for virtual screening. Like you can use something like Doc, D-O-C-K, Doc. That is actually for virtual screening. But then I think the call is on Achilles. Achilles Moria, he can actually tell you that what exactly we are planning for the lab session.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
It's a very nice presentation.
Yeah, tell me.
So my question is, how do I approach a docking if I have a increasing gradual increase of temperature as well as a gradient as a parameter?
The concept of temperature came into you are asking me something about simulated annealing.
Yes, sir. I'm asking related to REMD.
Okay. So you know that there is as such in docking software you don't have anything by which you can change the temperature parameter. But you can take a temperature parameter in two ways. One is that you can change the temperature parameter in your molecular dynamic, and then do some changes of the, like you take some snapshot of the same protein. Like if you're taking one protein and changing the temperature and you are doing a molecular dynamics, it will give you a trajectory file. Mm-hmm. Yes. And from the trajectory file, you can save multiple such scenario of the same protein. Like if I'll save hundreds of snapshots at different temperatures. So that means it can mimic somehow that what will be the overall configuration changes of the protein in different temperature. So you can take hundreds of snapshots, then you take it and try to dock it and see that how the docking is changing with the change in the configuration of the protein. Am I clear?
So I need to check whether the ligand is binding to the protein.
Yeah, you need to check that whether the ligand is binding to the protein or not. But that protein will be not the single protein now. The protein is the same protein with 100 different snapshots because you have changed this temperature 100 times.
Yes. So, but the position of the ligand where it binds, it also changes according to the increase in temperature sometimes.
Yeah, it will change.
So how do I manage that?
That's what I'm saying. If you change the temperature and if the temperature has something to do with the active site. So obviously when you are taking multiple snapshots, you will have multiple proteins with multiple active site configuration. Yes. And if you take it and do the docking with the ligand, then you can know that which particular configuration is having the maximum binding. That's it.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Sir, we are having some more questions. One is, what is blind docking?
Hello?
Can you please repeat it? Yes, sir. The question is, what is blind docking?
Okay. So blind docking means absolutely you don't have any idea that what is the active site. If you can remember the first two slides we have discussed, when we are dealing with a searching algorithm, the searching is two type. One is it will search through the entire surface to find out what is the active site, entire surface of the protein to find out which groove or which cavity is the active site. And second one that it has to search that within the active site, which configuration or which orientation is the best one. So blind docking actually, it starts with the idea that whether it is going into the same active site or not. So, essentially this can be done just to verify the accuracy of the software, and when you don't have any idea on the access side, you can do it.
Okay, sir. The another question that we are having is, what is protein-protein docking, and is it similar to protein-ligand docking?
Protein-protein docking is effectively the algorithm will be same, but the software will be different because you know when you are dealing with protein-ligand docking, we always try to see a concave cavity. Yes, like always the ligand will go inside the cavity of the protein. But the common sense says if you are dealing with two protein, the maximum configuration or the maximum point of contact will be more if the surface is flat. So when it is protein-protein docking, we are dealing with two flat surface. When it's protein ligand docking, we are dealing with a concave and a protein and a ligand, a concave cavity and with a ligand. But where is the protein-protein docking? It is more of associating two flat surface and to see that how beautifully they are binding. Am I clear?
Hello.
Okay.
So the next question is, which software gives us the better result for docking score, the Glide, Gold, or AutoDock?
There is nothing like good software or bad software. It all depends on what type of resources or simulation and what type of data you are dealing with. I will say they are effectively, all of them are good. The three names just now you have told. Like Glide is a good one. You have Gold, you have AutoDock. They all are equally good, because if you just go through few of the papers, how to find out the good and bad? So you can also try out, you know, you take 20 complexes, 20 protein ligand complex from the PDB on the way you are doing. Try to remove the ligand and use these three software, Gold, Glide, and AutoDock. You use all the three software and with the same complex just now you have downloaded from your PDB, and see that which software out of these three are mimicking the exact thing in maximum number of protein, you know. So if all these 20 protein, all the 20 ligands are going to exactly the same where, same places where the X-ray crystallography structure is already there, then I will say that is a winner software. But the literature and the references says these three are Gold, Glide, and AutoDock. They are equally good. I will not go for any one of them. It's perfectly like all are three good one. And then Glide is actually a paid one. Gold is also a paid one. AutoDock is a free one. So in that way, AutoDock is free.
Okay, sir, one more question. How could we perform docking for ions?
Okay, so we have, you can do the docking for ions, but then for that you have a different force field. So there are some force field which is there are some force field based scoring just now I told. So there are some force field which is effectively only for iron. So that is actually beyond the course, this thing of this course work. But then suddenly we'll try to take this iron docking. It's actually a bit more tricky, and you need to deal with it a bit more tricky way with the change of scoring function also. We'll discuss sometime else. I mean, this is not a right time, because that itself is a lengthy topic to discuss. Thank you.
Excuse me, sir.
Thank you, sir, for such a wonderful talk. I hope all the participants have enjoyed the talk as well as learned the basics of docking algorithms from sir's talk. The question I think everyone has asked questions, and we are over with question answer session. Thank you so much, sir, for joining us.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
And to all the participants, I would say that we will end our first session right over here, and we'll meet after 15 minutes. So it's around 12:13. We'll meet around 12:30 to start with our second session, where we'll give you hands-on experience to AutoDock. So how do you do the task? How do you analyze the results? Everything. I would request you to be along with your PC and laptop so that you can also do the exercise along with the instructor, so that you learn it in a more efficient manner. So now we will go for a break and join after 15 minutes.
Thank you. Thank you, madam.
Thank you, sir.